In the video you are about to watch, I'm referring to the very beginning of moving on from fossil fuels with respect to transport only. Because of the development of the battery, the only obstacle to full electric transport, I'm not referring to the production of electricity. I'll just repeat that. In this video, I'm referring to the very beginning of moving on from fossil fuels with respect to transport, because of the development of the battery, the only obstacle to full electric transport. I'm not referring to the production of electricity. We have moved on from fossil fuels. The rest of this video is a video to the future. I want to be one of the first to say we have moved on from fossil fuel engines. First off, I never thought I would see it in my lifetime. At the time of moving on from fossil fuels, virtually today, everybody knew we needed to move on to another system, a cleaner system. The people working in the servos or the petrol stations, just about all road users and even the fuel suppliers, worldwide political systems and all forward-thinking businesses. Everyone, unfortunately, except the current political system holding power here today. Unfortunately, their view is not to contribute money or intellectual property and to just let it all come to them to be shipped over. And in my view, that's a shame. That we could be remembered that way, this country. However, in the future, it can be overcome. And maybe a political system will be elected that wants to take a forward-thinking approach, and I hope so. The main tries and electric vehicle technology is coming from Europe, the USA and Asia. Driving a fossil fuel engine, it's not like it is now with an accelerator pedal and brake. The old machines, the ones with clutch and gears, took considerable skill to drive. While dealing with other road users and lights, indication, pedestrians, direction, etc., we also had to match our road speed to the appropriate gear while using a clutch pedal to disengage the engine from the gearbox to make the gear change, while braking or accelerating at the same time. There were more basic but harder to use gearboxes used in large trucks called constant mesh gearboxes. They had 18 gears. 18 gears. You could change gears up without the clutch because the gears were matched so closely. But if you wanted to skip a gear, say from 7th to 4th, you had to match your speed to gear exactly. There was a high and low range for every gear in these types of trucks. There was considerable oil and slick on the road surface, and this oil would be dangerous and slippery after rain if it hadn't rained in a while. Now, the only barrier after widespread agreement that we needed to leave fossil fuel transport behind was the battery's ability to hold enough power to power the vehicle to a good enough range, say for instance, I'd say 200 kilometers or 124 miles. And of course, the fossil fuel capitalists were aggressive in trying to remain. In the 1980s and 1990s, which was pre-internet, there was a very real danger in designing, patenting, and producing a non-fossil fuel engine. The feeling was in the community that you could disappear or your life could be ruined if you pursued a non-fossil fuel engine. Fossil fuel vehicles were very complex and becoming increasingly complex. Toward the end of the fossil fuel time, the cars were being built so complex that by the time the car reached 250 or 300,000 kilometers, the car would be almost too complex for the average person with moderate mechanical knowledge to fix. In the 1970s, the peak of the fossil fuel car in design and engine build, the 1980s and 1990s, you could purchase a car built in these years, replace the spark plugs, leads, distributor cap, rotor or points, fuel pump, coil, fuel filter, battery, and get many years of usage if you change the oil regularly every 5,000 kilometers or so, which is 3,100 miles. In the days of the fossil fuel engine, you would regularly come across an old vehicle on the road, be it diesel or LPG gas or propane or petrol, which is called gas in the USA, that would blow toxic smoke that would smell terrible and harm your health. I mean, it smelled bad, and you'd have to wind down your windows and go like this, try and get some circulation. You wouldn't know, you know, you'd be driving along, you wouldn't know where it was coming from, but you'd certainly smell it, and it was just terrible. You would need to roll down your windows and change lanes. This was due to worn rings on the piston within the fossil fuel engine, or in the bore of the engine, or a wrong fuel to air mixture, etc. If it was internal engines with parts, with say for instance piston rings, it'd be fairly expensive, very expensive to get a mechanic to fix this problem. It was a real problem in the day that I'm living now, and I don't think it'd be worth fixing your car if you had to have your pistons and rings changed. Probably better off getting another car, I think. If you purchased an older car with say 250,000 kilometres or more, or 155 miles that hadn't been serviced, the car would need a lot of components and work and trouble diagnosis, rust removal, etc. In the days of fossil fuel engines, as it probably is now, you would take your car to the mechanics, pay a lot of money, and when you check the work done that you paid for, you would find that not all of the parts were replaced, or you would pay breathtakingly high prices for not much work done. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to tell two stories of experiences that workmates or colleagues of mine have had with fossil fuel engines just recently. One colleague of mine recently purchased a car for $17,000. He had a mechanic, or he's got a mechanic, and he asked the mechanic to check out the car. The mechanic unfortunately walked around the outside of the car, noticed that the car had a good duco, a good paint job, and recommended the car. Now, he drove the car around, and the first time it underperformed, he took it to the mechanic, and he ended up paying the mechanic another $17,000 to fix all the parts on the car. So the mechanic didn't do any type of test or have a look at the electrical components or do a an engine compression test. He just noticed that the car looked good and recommended it. Another work colleague of mine paid $40,000 for a car. It had what's known as a triptonic gearbox. It's an electrical gearbox, and it has electric, as far as I know, it's got electrical motors that do the gear changes. And the car broke down on the freeway, and I'm not sure, but I think I drove past this car while it was broken down on the freeway, and it can't be towed, you see. So what they had to do is bring in a crane, lift the car up onto a truck, and the car was worth nothing. So he paid $40,000 for it, and he told me he got about $500 back for it. And he doesn't drive a car anymore, he takes a train. I don't blame him. I got my license and started owning fossil fuel engines to use for transport from the age of 17, and I'm 48 now. I've experienced many times when my car would break down and be worth nothing. The only way to own a fossil fuel machine in this day and age, now when I'm living now, if you weren't a high income earner, was to be able to maintain service and fix the machine yourself. Maintenance of the fossil fuel motor. Fossil fuel motors were very complex, with many moving pistons, cranks, cogs and electrical components. Some cars had 8, even 12 pistons, and some 12 cylinder motors. I think it was a Jaguar had a 12 cylinder motor. They were fairly well known for having a 12 cylinder motor. It had 12 pistons, 12 injectors, 12 spark plugs, 12 distributor leads, and 12 fuel inlets and exhaust outlets. The maintenance costs must have been very high for this type of engine. The new fossil fuel cars toward the start of the electrical vehicle time, or now, even had a coil connected to the spark plugs, the spark plug lead. So a V8 would have 8 coils, and some cars had 3 or more fuse boxes. I think it's Holden, which is General Motors. They make the Chevy in the USA. Yeah, I was having a look at a video on YouTube, and you got the spark plug lead, and it's actually got a box on top of every spark plug lead, and that's a coil. So, very expensive. I'm going to talk now about the loved noise caused by a fossil fuel motor. The noise caused by the fossil fuel motor was liked by the male, but most females didn't like the noise. The male would purchase mufflers that would cause the noise to be louder and lower in pitch. I noticed some mufflers were available in auto shops starting around about 2007, but they could have been, and probably were, available before then. And they were chrome. These mufflers were more than the decibel range permitted. They were mostly used by Subaru drivers and to a lesser extent Mitsubishi users. The 1970s V8 noise was the most loved noise of the fossil fuel engine time. The female of the time wasn't silly. The female wasn't as interested in the engine. In fact, the other day at work, only about 2 days ago, there was a lady with a broken down car on the road, and she was on the phone trying to lift up the hood to look at the motor, and she didn't know how to lift up a hood. With absolute full respect to women, I don't mean to demean women by saying that, but that is actually a true story. Now this is a funny phenomenon of the time that I live in. You would hear people with loud, usually V8 engines, come into the area where you lived and burn the tyres. Burn the tyres is spinning the tyres around, revving the engine hard and letting out the clutch. And make a lot of noise. This would last about half an hour. Then the driver would go away. Now, God knows, you know, why a person would want to do that. Having caused a lot of damage and expense to his own car, you know, something like that, the noise that it made, and it's almost a terrorist attack, or at least a terrorist act. Yeah, you'd just be sitting there on the weekend, or whenever, and a car would just come along and make a lot of noise in your area and leave. But the noise was the only thing loved of the fossil fuel motor. The fossil fuel motor was dirtier, more complex, costly, and slower, and more parts to go wrong than electric engines. Once again, I'd just like to say, full respect to women. Women don't play a part in wars. You never see a woman or women fighting on the battlefront, and women are peace loving people, but in respect to cars, they're just not as interested in the car motor. Okay, so a big problem with fossil fuel motors was that the parts were lubricated by motor oil, some mostly called engine oil. And this oil sat in the engine. In other words, it wasn't renewed continuously. We used oil filters made of a paper element filtering the oil. This oil needed to be changed every 5,000 kilometres or 3,000 miles at least. However, a lot of car manufacturers' maintenance schedules had 10, even 15,000 as the oil change point. Lack of oil changing was a major cause of wear and damage in a fossil fuel engine, as well as over revving and hard acceleration. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is just I'm going to film and talk about the actual evidence of having moved on from fossil fuel engines. The other day at work, within 2 or 3 days, I saw 4 electric cars, and I've never experienced that before. And if you know what to look for, there's quite a few of them on the road, and there's quickly becoming more. The signs of an electric car are, you look at the front and there's no gap for the air to flow through and hit the radiator and cool the engine down. If you look at the back, there's no exhaust pipe. Okay, so in Australia at least, where I live, the first evidence that there was going to be a change from fossil fuel engines was this car. It's called the Prius. It's made by Toyota, and it's got both a fossil fuel engine and an electrical motor in it. I've never seen this one in Australia. This is called a Honda Fit. This guy's English, an Englishman, he's doing a review of this car. That's one car that I found YouTubing, and that is an electric only car. This is a car I've seen at least 2 of these in the last 3 days at work. I'm a truck driver, so I get out and about a fair amount on the roads. This is called the e-Golf, and that's an electric only car. This is called the Zero motorcycle. These are all electric motorcycles. And this is the Harley Davidson first electric motorbike. It's called the Livewire. I'm thinking of purchasing one myself, and believe me, if Harley Davidson are going to make an electric bike, electric motors are definitely the way of the future. Okay, I'm up to my last page of this blog. I'm going to talk now about fueling up, putting fuel in the tank. We put petrol or diesel in our fuel tanks, or propane. Here it's called LPG, liquid petroleum gas, in our high pressure propane gas tanks. There's a story of one of these exploding in Sydney going back 1 or 2 years ago, and I know that I had a liquid petroleum gas on my car, and sometimes it leaked. Once it leaked, one morning it leaked, and I turned on the ignition. When the engine turned and the spark to ignite the within the distributor, and there was a gas build up under the hood at the front of the car, and my car sort of burst quickly in flames. But there's a story a couple of years ago, a bloke, his gas tank exploded, and it took out a few houses with it. Diesel oil was used to power all heavy combination trucks, so that's here it's called heavy combination vehicles or multi-combination vehicles. In England it's known as lorry. In the USA it's known as tractor trailer trucks, and some cars, so that's diesel. Diesel was not combustible. Diesel is a type of thin oil. It's not a very thick oil, but it ignites under pressure. So you've got the piston here and the head of the engine here, and the piston comes up and that pressure ignites it. It's got a glow plug and that ignites the diesel. And some cars of this era also use a small diesel engine. Diesel was not combustible. Petrol, called gas in the USA, and LPG, liquid petroleum gas, called propane in the USA, was very explosive. You couldn't smoke cigarettes when you went to fuel up. It took about 4 to 5 minutes to fuel the tank. If you fueled up with petrol, you had about 3 octane mixes to choose from. So there'd be 3 pump handles that you could pull out from the pump, and the octane mixes were from 92 to 98 octane. The higher being the more explosive. And some old cars and new cars, and you can find the best mix for you and the best price for you, because the lower octane usually almost always is lower the price. You would pay about $45 to fill a 2.6 litre engine tank when the average wage was roughly $700, and you could do 6 to 7 85 kilometre trips. So you could go, if your work was 85 kilometres away, you could go to work and back 6 to 7 times with a fuel economical car. And of course, if you drove smoothly, I imagine in the far future, the smoother you are and the less you accelerate with your electrical engine, the further you'll go. Once you fueled up, you would go into the petrol shop and pay. Sometimes you could pay at the petrol pump with a card. Now imagine in the far future you'll be able to charge your car up at home. These days we can't fuel up at home because it's not electrical, it's a combustible material. But I also imagine in the future, if you're going long distances, and especially trucks, that you'll have to recharge at a recharge station. Okay, and last but not least, I'd like to talk now about a place for fossil fuel engines in the future. No doubt the fossil fuel engine will live on. Fossil fuel engines will be used as spare engines, generators, and sport. For example, where would monster trucks of big wheeled stunt cars and trucks be without the fossil fuel engine V8 noise? I think that F1 race cars will be one of the first race cars to move on to electric power because of performance. However, NASCAR, drag cars, and monster truck racing may always remain fossil fuel.